We have a career close-up episode for you today. Hi, this is Shop Talk, and I'm Ria Tanuat-Cotrillo. One photo of a mouth-watering dish is enough to make us order and try the food captured in the photograph. Today, we'll talk about what it takes to be a food photographer. And for that, we're joined by Mylene Chung. She is the co-founder of the Photo Kitchen Food Photography. And later on, we'll also talk about the food photography classes handled by Mylene through 50 Feasts. Hello, Mylene. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me.
All right. Okay. You are a food photographer by profession. Tell us how you got your start. You're a communications graduate from Ateneo,
yeah.
So kind of started there, right?
Yeah, sort of. Actually, a friend once brought his really huge SLR camera in school, and I was so amazed with it, so I decided to tinker with it bit by bit, and he actually taught me a bit of the basics, and after that, I got my first DSLR for myself. Actually, it was for my birthday, and Gradually, I learned more about the basic principles of photography. I initially started as a fashion photographer. I shot lots of people. I did a lot of people portraiture. But gradually, I realized that fashion photography wasn't much for me because I had difficulty directing models, communicating what I really wanted them to do.
Okay.
So I ventured into still life photography. And that was when I found my passion for food because I love to eat. At the same time, I also love to create cute sets from scratch, and with that I create sets for my food as well. So that's how I started.
Right, okay. So your first experience of photography, or at least an instructional sort of setup, mm-hmm. For photography was in Ateneo, in a photography class.
Yeah, actually.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. How did you hone your craft after that?
Our class in Ateneo was purely basic. So you just study the basics of shutter speed, ISO, so it's like every other basic photography class. But right after, I started shooting more food. I bought random dishes from fast food chains and just brought them home, tried to play with it a bit, collected lots of plates in the process, plates, utensils, and also random surfaces from junk shops, and just put them together. And gradually, I started shooting, and I built a portfolio for myself that is mostly food. And that's when I realized that I really wanted to do this.
This was your thing. Yeah, I talked to a lot of photographers and they do say that a lot of them took a basic course and then from there it was just really just playing around, learning how to use
yeah.
the camera,
you
and developing your own style. Right, right. Invest that time in there. But one of the first major projects you had was your thesis.
Yes.
For your communications degree. Tell me about that. It was like a recipe book for OFWs, right?
Yes, actually it was a recipe book for Filipinos living abroad. We had lots of Filipino dishes just for them, just to have them reminisce what it felt like to taste Filipino dishes again while they're there. We shot very, what do you call that, very quintessential Filipino dishes like sinigang, adobo. But I would admit during that time my shots were really crappy, and that was when I wanted to really improve on it. So
right, how would you describe your style? I mean, you know, you have photographers, mm-hmm. artists, stylists, and even makeup artists, mm-hmm. and when you see their work you know that they were
That's
the person
correct,
behind
yeah.
it, right? What's your signature look?
Actually, my style really depends on how I prop style my dishes. Most food photographers have separate prop stylists in hand, but I prefer really to have full control of the set. I love shooting minimalistic setups, like very white, very, very Japanese feel. I also love playing with wooden elements like rattan table napkins or rustic distressed wood. So that's sort of my style.
Right, and that's what we're seeing there on the screen.
Yes.
And even the setup here, mm-hmm. on the studio, very sort of rustic, very country.
Yes.
But also like still very, very simple.
Yes, very simple.
Right, okay. So you in a way are like, you're almost a food stylist, would you say?
In our industry, a food stylist is really separate from the food photographer, because what the food stylist does, she makes the food, the dish in itself, look a lot more appetizing. Like she creates fake ice cream for you that doesn't melt on set. But what a prop stylist does, which is also what I do when I shoot, I create the actual environment that the food is placed into.
Ah, okay. So prop stylist
Yes.
and
Food
food stylist. Okay, so you can do the prop styling
Yes. But here in the
yourself.
Philippines, we are not still very familiar with the term prop styling because usually we merge food stylist with prop
Correct.
styling.
Right. Okay, so now you're doing that. But
Yes.
I'm looking at your photos. They look great.
Thank you.
But that is also the trend now. I mean, I look at like whether you check online or
Yes.
various cookbooks, it is very minimalist, very clean
Yes.
and crisp,
And they
right?
also love using wooden elements, organic elements.
Right. Great. That looks great. Okay. What are the most difficult things to shoot? There, you talked about ice cream. If you're going to shoot ice cream, you need fake ice cream. Otherwise, it's going to melt on you, right?
Yes, but we also have some clients, some ice cream clients, who are more like purists because they want to use their actual products. That's why with those clients, we really have to work fast, work really fast so that the ice cream won't melt on set. And you have to be very meticulous. Like once you style it, you can't go back or else you have to restart again.
Okay. All right. And when people hire your services,
mm-hmm.
What packages do you offer for that? Is it per shooting day, per hour? Does that include the layout?
Actually, it's very similar to all photographers. We have a day rate. Our day rate is comprised of 8 hours. It basically includes everything that you can shoot within a span of 8 hours.
All right.
We also have a per layout rate. Usually our per layout rate comes with the premium layout because that's when we style prop style and also food style per item. So usually those are more expensive.
Right. And who are your clients? Is it for commercials? Is it for magazines, for books?
I actually contribute regularly to Yummy Magazine. Apart from that, most of our clients are restaurants and big food companies like CDO, Kingsway. We also have Saints Alp Tea House, which we did just yesterday. Red Mango was actually one of our first clients.
Nice. Right. And do you get to try the food that you shoot?
Yes, that's the fun part of it, actually, because you get to taste everything.
Right. That's the best part, right? What about when it comes to shooting hot food? What are the challenges you're presented with then?
I guess when shooting hot food, you really need a good partner food stylist for it. Because, for example, when it comes to steak, after a long time of shooting, the oil itself hardens. So
right.
You need someone to like step in and sort of heat everything up or like put grill marks on the steak so that they won't fade away.
Right.
So it becomes more difficult because hot food sets in a more ugly manner. That's why you really have to be meticulous. You really have to step in, step out, just to keep it looking fresh.
Right. So that's part of the pressure of your job, really.
Yes.
Just being able to get the image
Yes.
fast,
mm-hmm.
right? And when you work, do you choose the food stylists you work with?
Actually, in our company, we have two in-house food stylists. They're more of partner food stylists, but they still do food styling freelance.
Right.
Recently, I work a lot with Catherine Howe. She's actually a really good chef and a food stylist as well. She works a lot with Yummy Magazine. And I'm very comfortable working with her because our styles match very well and we complement each other's skills. So it's really important when you're shooting food that you're comfortable with your team, because if one doesn't like the setup you're created,
yeah.
then you'll be clashing.
For sure, for sure. When it comes to the equipment for food photography, what are the things that you need? And is there anything that's especially for food photography?
Actually, food photography, it's just a secret, but oh well. For food photography, it doesn't take so much to start it because you're good with just the natural light from a window. You can go with an entry-level camera and just a tripod, then you can shoot amazing photos already.
So it doesn't have to be anything
Yes.
complicated, no kinds of... Because I know with fashion photography,
mm-hmm.
there's all kinds of lights to create certain effects and whatnot. But for food photography, you're saying it's not as complex.
When it comes to me, I really like natural light best, but there are some clients who want commercial effects for their layouts. So I make sure to bring extra artificial lights on set. But when for an entry level setup, you just really need a huge window and a simple camera, even a point and shoot camera what that's a bit more like an SLR.
Right.
Will do already.
Okay, so I'm looking at your photos. These are all natural light. It looks like it.
Yes.
Or do you just have us fooled?
yeah, actually, most of it is natural light.
Right. And yeah, I like it because it makes the food, I don't know, it just makes it come alive
out,
more,
yeah.
Right? And it makes it, like you said, pop out more, right? Okay. Tell me about the setup that mm-hmm. we have here. So we mentioned that your style is sort of rustic mm-hmm. and country,
very
but very simple. So tell me about all the elements you have here.
Actually, I love using artificial elements for the background because you don't really see them when it translates.
Yeah, you don't
photo.
Need the detail.
Yeah, it just blurs out. So I usually use fake plants. I have a collection in the studio of a lot of fake plants. I actually got this kind of garden pot from Dapitan, which is mostly very old stuff.
Right.
I got it for only 20 pesos. And I make sure to invest in a lot of surfaces. Okay. Sometimes I get surfaces from junk shops. I also have surfaces made just for a specific set.
Okay, so where do you get this? Where do you get like these planks kind of stuck together?
Yeah, actually this one I just had a contractor make it for
me.
I just specified what kind of finish I wanted. I also love using very Japanese elements on set, especially if it's part of the peg of the client. I love using very neutral tones, flesh, greens, and very relaxing environment for the food.
Something where that would really make you feel like you want to eat.
Yes.
Right? Okay, we have lots more to talk about with Mylene. We'll talk about the food photography classes that Mylene holds at 50 Feasts after this break. Keep it here. Shop Talk, we'll be right back. Welcome back to Shop Talk, and still with us is food photographer Mylene Chung. Mylene is the co-founder of Photo Kitchen Food Photography, and she teaches food photography at 50 Feasts. Okay, tell me about 50 Feasts. It's sort of like, I guess, a natural or organic growth from what you were already doing as a food photographer.
Yes, actually 50 Feasts is like an avenue where I can actually teach what I do. I teach there everything I've learned throughout my career as a food photographer. So we have a basic photography class, which basically tackles the basic, very basic principles of photography. We also have a basic food photography class, which is mostly dealing with natural light photography. And we also have a master's class, which will tackle on artificial lighting, how to light commercial setups for food. And lastly, we have a food styling class instructed by our in-house food stylist, Catherine, who teaches how to style big roast chicken or ice cream.
All right, yeah, the food styling, which isn't even really food anymore,
yes.
Right? Okay, that sort of thing. And looking at these pictures, where is this? Is this in your studio,
yes.
In your home?
This is actually in our studio. Our studio looks very much like a home setup. We have a living room, a kitchen, and we have a really huge window so that all the students can make use of natural light efficiently.
Oh, okay. And they do say that's like the mark of a good photographer,
yes.
One who can really make proper use of the available light. Right, okay. So you mentioned those four courses. That's basic photography, basic food photography, food styling 101, and then the food photography master class. So I take it for the master class, you should have taken the other three classes before that.
It's just required that you take the basic food photography class.
Oh, okay. I see. And then like how many hours is each class?
We actually have it for 2 days. The basic food photography class starts from 10 o'clock a.m. to around 5 p.m. So for those 2 days, that's our duration. For the basic photography class, it's much shorter. It's 2 days. It starts at around 12 o'clock until around 5 o'clock.
Right. Okay. I'm seeing a different set of photos now, and these are by your students, right?
Oh, actually, these are still mine.
Okay.
The one by my students is another set.
Oh, okay. I see. But what do they tell you? What's the feedback that you get after they've gone through like a whole set of classes?
Actually, most of our students are very happy with what they've learned, because what I teach them is something that is quite obvious, but you don't really practice it normally. So I teach them some tricks I've been doing for the past how many years, and they're actually very surprised. It's just there, right, in their camera, but they've never encountered it before. They never decided to go through with it.
Right. So you use a particular setting,
yes,
in a particular situation.
A particular technique.
Right, right. Okay. And what are your food photography tips?
I would say one of my food photography tip to create really good and appetizing dishes look translate into photos would be, number one, you have to be really patient and you have to be flexible, because a lot of times you'll be working with clients who wouldn't like the peg that you gave them. So you have to really find a compromise between what they want and what you want. Another tip I would give is you should be very meticulous with the actual food items you're going to be shooting. A little crumb that is out of place can already affect the entire look of your photograph. Another one would be to use a monochrome palette. You will never go wrong with using a very monochrome set. This, for example, is a very monochrome set. You find their flushes, very desaturated greens, and also the background element, which is the flower, is still very much close to the colors of your main dish. So that's another tip I would give.
Right. Okay. And you also say that you should find the right light for your mood.
Yes. When it comes to food, since you're going to be dealing with a lot of natural light, you really have to know what kind of light you'll be using, because there are different kinds of light, natural light, that is. For example, if you want to create a very morning setup, like you're having breakfast, you have to use early morning light, which is very harsh, which creates much more shadows on the other side. Okay. Another light would be cloudy daylight, which creates a softer light, because the light becomes diffused by the clouds, and therefore the light becomes softer, more feminine also.
Right. Okay. What about sunset light? People tell me sunset light is great, at least for like skin tones. Is it good for food?
Well, you can use it. It's very much similar to early morning light, because you have very harsh lights coming in.
And the shadows.
And the shadows are very harsh as well.
Right. Okay. What would you say is the biggest fulfillment you get out of being a food photographer?
That would definitely be seeing your photos in the news and billboards. Because you know that you're the one who created that, it's your hard work, and you see that being seen by everyone else. So that's one of the biggest fulfillment. Also, seeing your clients very happy. I have clients who start calling me, telling me that, wow, their dishes really sell, because people are starting to notice their dishes more. So that's one of the biggest fulfillment.
Okay, and another question, of course, would be the financial compensation. Mm-hmm. How would your income, say, compare to your batchmates who are also in communications, who are, say, working in advertising or the corporate world?
What I like about this job is I have a very flexible schedule, so I don't have to work every single day, and I still get a good income coming in every month. But the downside is when you start off during your first year, it's very unstable, because you can't really predict how many clients you get per month. Sometimes there are months that where we would get like zero clients, and I'm like crying my eyes out.
What am I gonna do?
Yeah, what am I gonna do? But you just have to be really patient, build your portfolio. Gradually, you'll get out there.
Yeah, so now I'm thinking you don't have those days anymore where you don't have anything booked.
Recently, it's better. But when we first started, I had like days when I would be worrying, what are we going to be doing?
Right, yeah. Right. Well, I guess that's all part and parcel of you know, working your way up there.
Yes.
Right. And it's nice to own your own time.
Yes.
Right.
One of the best.
All right. For newbies, what advice could you give them about breaking into the food photography scene?
I guess they could start by building their own portfolio. When I started, I just got random orders from McDo. I actually shot a chicken dish of McDo just right in my house. I started like buying random stuff, making my own onigiri dish, and just shooting it after. And they can start there. They can build their own portfolio and start submitting their portfolios in magazines. Maybe they can get gigs also in magazines so that they can get exposed more. And I would advise them to be really patient, because you don't really get instant clients after exposing your portfolio. But just be patient, just do what you love, because if you do what you love, you don't really, it's not really required that you get a lot of compensation from it.
Right, because there's a sort of psychological,
yes.
Spiritual satisfaction,
yes.
You
it's
get
like a hobby.
From doing it anyway, mm-hmm. Right?
Yes.
Great. Okay. What about for people who want to get into photography in general? What would your advice be for them?
Well,
and like, how do you know if a certain kind of photography is for you or not for you? Like you said, you started in fashion, but you mm-hmm. figured it wasn't for you.
Actually, I think you just have to find a middle ground between your hobbies. Look at what you like aside from photography. Like, for example, me, I love our arts and crafts. I love creating like cards before, handmade cards. So that was when I realized, what if I designed sets for my food? Maybe it'll make the food look more appetizing afterwards. So you have to find that middle ground. For example, I know this photographer. He's her AKA photographer. He's called the photographer because he loves cars and he shoots a lot of cars. So he's really well known now. He shoots really big car brands in the States.
Wow.
So just find that middle ground. Look at your hobbies. What do you like to do aside from photography? And maybe you can integrate it into
right.
your photography.
Merge
yes.
them. And don't be afraid to sell yourself,
yes,
you said.
Definitely.
Right? Okay, and looking forward, what are the plans for your business and
mm-hmm.
for 50 Feasts?
I really want to make 50 Feasts grow. I want it to be a bigger school in the future. I want to tackle more on a lot more things. Like, for example, I want to bring in someone who can teach branding and menu design, because it's part and parcel with photography. Apart from that, I really want to shoot for more international clients in the future. Like, I've grown with magazines like Donahay.
I love Donahay.
Yeah,
pictures.
I love Donahay.
Yeah.
And also Delicious magazine from Australia. I've grown with those magazines. Those are my biggest inspirations.
Right.
And hopefully one day I get to shoot with them in the future. So,
all right, lots
one
of stuff
goals.
To look forward
yeah.
to. Thank you, Mylene. And thank all of you for watching Shop Talk. I'm Ria Tanwatko Trivio. Follow ANC Shop Talk on Twitter and be a fan of ANC Shop Talk on Facebook. Enjoy the rest of your day.